September 11th started out just like any other day at the Portland Jetport.
RITT.
How many bags checking total today?
One.
By 5:30 that morning, most U.S. Airways passengers had checked in and were already headed for their gates. The day was already flying along for then customer service agent Mike Tui.
So I was about to take a break and step out on the curb, you know, and then I noticed two fellas standing there. And I said, no, I'll take care of these guys before I take a break.
Those guys were Muhammad Atta and Abdulaziz Al-Omari, two of the 19 now infamous hijackers.
And they stepped up, and you know, I kind of looked at them, didn't pay too much attention initially. Then, you know, you fall into your procedure of check-in. You ask them if they have any bags to check, and then you ask them the security questions, and you ask them for their identification. You know, you have to look at them in their license. Then I looked at them and I saw, it made the hair on my back of my neck stand up. You could feel, it was palpable. You could feel the anger coming out of this man for some reason. And then a thought registered in my head. It had never, ever done that before. It said, if this guy doesn't look like an Arab terrorist, nobody does. That's the exact words that ran through my head. And then I gave myself kind of a mental slap, and I said, that's not right, you know?
Despite Mike Tui's misgivings, the two men boarded the U.S. Airways flight headed for Boston. There, they switched airlines and got on American Flight 11. A coworker told Tui that that flight had hit the World Trade Center.
And I felt terrible. I says, oh. I says, I put two guys on that plane. I said, I put two guys in first class on that plane. And I'm thinking, and here I am thinking they're terrorists, and now the poor buggers are dead. Then you found out about the next plane hitting the aircraft, the building, the other building. And then I said, I was right. They were terrorists. These guys caused that American Airlines flight to crash into that building, somehow.
But it wasn't until the next day that the weight of it all hit Mike Tui.
I was watching television, and then I actually started seeing the horror of it all. And I've got this, I started sobbing and crying uncontrollably. I didn't know what to do, so I called my mother. She told me it wasn't my fault. She said, things will be okay. And she stayed with me a few days. And, you know, things seemed to be all right after that.
And Tui says it stayed all right for the next couple years, until 2004, when he retired.
It was only then that I really started having problems. Psychological problems, occasional flashbacks and unpleasant memories, and you can't get away from it. That's the whole thing. You just can't get away from it.
Over the years, through counseling, Tui says his guilt turned into anger.
Because over the years, we've come to find out how much information was known about this. The PDB, the Presidential Daily Briefing of August 6th, you know, it said, New York City, buildings, aircraft, Osama bin Laden, Al-Qaeda, hijack. Now, why didn't they pass that on to the airline industry? Why did they keep that a secret? That there might be people who were going to use aircraft for weapons. Why weren't we told of this?
Even with counseling, 5 years later, questions still keep Mike Tui up at night. Muhammad Atta was the ringleader of the terrorist group. What if Tui had stopped him from getting on that plane? Would he have called off the attacks?
It's the question of questions for me for all these years. I couldn't do anything different. If you stopped him from going on the plane and you were wrong, your career's finished, you're done. If I'm wrong. Now, my chances of being right are... What? It's never happened before.
Mike Toohey will carry that with him for the rest of his life. The weight of that what if.